Welcome to the CCFR Radio Podcast, your source for news, updates, and stories from the CCFR. Hey everybody, welcome to episode 24 of the CCFR Radio Podcast. I'm your host, Rod Giltaka, and it's going to be a bit of a weird episode. It's going to be sort of relatively quick. I'm just not going to say a whole lot. I'm going to play an interview that I just did, actually, with a radio station here in Vancouver, British Columbia. So let me tell you first why I'm making this strange episode. So tomorrow morning, Tracy Wilson and I are flying out to Halifax to the Conservative Party Policy Convention. And so I don't have a whole lot of time. I won't be available to do a podcast this Thursday because I'll be there. And I did want to just mention a couple of things, tell you a couple of things that are coming up. So sort of a CCFR update. And I also wanted to play an interview I just got off the phone from doing. Thanks to Matt Algio for extracting that. And it was just really great. I think I was on for 30 minutes, which is probably a record, certainly for any gun group, as far as I'm concerned, certainly a record for the CCFR. And it really gave gun owners a bit of a platform. So that's why I'm so excited about it. And also during the interview, I stuttered a little bit, but I also came out with some really salient points. So I'm hoping that by you guys listening to this, it just helps you in your individual arguments out there. And in doing what I'm doing and the CCFR is doing, which is desperately trying to stop the madness. Everybody's going crazy. So first thing I want to talk about was a quick update of stuff. You know, I would normally mention some new stuff like Montreal City Council passing a motion unanimously to ban assault weapons in Canada. These idiots don't even know that assault weapons are banned for the last 80 years in Canada. They don't even know what the what the definition of assault weapon is. That's how bad things are out there. And if you disagree, apparently you're a bigot. So it's a very difficult time in Canada to talk with any kind of reason and fact and calmly, but we got to keep trying to do it. So anyway, I saw that this morning and I just was falling out of the chair. I'm like, how did the state of discourse in Canada get to this point? How divided are Canadians? And the Prime Minister continues to divide Canadians. And, you know, it's funny, as I'm spewing all this stuff off, I'm like, I never wanted this to be political in the first place, but they've left us no choice. So anyway, yeah, everybody's going crazy out there. Things are going really fast. We're trying desperately to stop it. So all I would ask is that all of you out there refine your arguments, stay calm. I'm trying to lead by example, not always easy, but try to stay calm and keep that conversation going. And by being the reasonable voice in the room, that's actually the only way for us to get our message heard. We've tried acting like orangutans and that has not worked. So keep debating with people, and for God's sakes, please support the CCFR. I actually had a conversation with Tracy Wilson this morning. Wanted to check the bank balance to make sure that we're okay to go to Halifax and to continue to put out these political videos and the memes and the TV show and everything that we're trying to do. We've got a lot more projects coming that will be really, really good for gun owners. So to do that, we need to be able to pay for that stuff. And I can't pay for it by myself, and either can just the existing people that are paying for stuff. So please support the CCFR if you like what we're doing, and we really want to continue. No time in history has the CCFR been so badly needed in this conversation. So a couple of quick updates, and then forget the commercials this time around. I'm going to give you a couple of updates, and we're going to go straight to this interview. And this interview was, I'm going to say CCFR for the win. I'll make a couple other comments before I start it. So as far as updates are concerned, if you want to support the CCFR monthly, please consider doing that by going to Patreon, searching for the CCFR. I think it's patreon.com/CCFR, if I'm not mistaken. But you can go to Patreon and give us a monthly gift to support us throughout the year. That really helps us in budgeting, because we will sort of know what we have coming each month when we have donations. I mean, they're great, don't get me wrong, but when we have donations and we have memberships, we have no idea what's coming in when, and that makes it really difficult to say yes, we'll take on this project, because we know we have X number of dollars coming in per month. So that helps smooth our revenue curve over, smooth it out a lot. So that would be really meaningful. So Patreon, search for the CCFR, a monthly gift would really be very well appreciated. Now, if you contribute more than, well, $20 or more to the CCFR on Patreon, then you will be entered into the CCFR Insiders Club. Now, what that is, it's a It's a secret Facebook group that you can be part of. Once you do that donation, I think it'll just take a couple of days. You'll be added to that group, and then we'll send you an email to say, here's how you get in. And basically you'll have access to Tracy Wilson and myself half an hour per month. Truthfully, is it going to be half an hour? No, it's going to be longer than that. But basically we'll do a Facebook Live, and you and only that insider group of donors will have access to us to ask us questions and talk to us basically directly. So that's what we can offer now. We're trying to do everything we can to get people to help us, and we're trying to return some value. So rather than just say, give us money, we always want to trade you something for value. So if it's a membership, obviously that's insurance and some other benefits. If it's a business member, you have access to the Facebook group of 23, almost 24,000 people now to exclusively advertise your product or your service, stuff like that. So anyway, Patreon, search for the CCFR, become a Patreon supporter. Now, one more thing I'll mention is we have a new contest coming out. It's called the Ultimate Choice 2. And basically, if you win this contest, you will have your choice of three ultimate packages, a ultimate long range package, an ultimate tactical package, or an ultimate hunter's package. And it's our friends, our very good friends over at CCFR. We are the CCFR, bro. SFRC, also found on the internet at www.theammosource.com. We partnered up with Ryan over at SFRC, and they are providing all of the prize packs for this contest. So thank you very much for Ryan for helping us out with that. And we will have this contest starting this Friday. Okay, so Friday where's my calendar? Stand by. I should give you the date. That's a little irresponsible. This Friday is the 24th, August 24th, and the contest is going to close on September the 30th. I'm doing this all by memory. So basically, if you buy a ticket for $25, you're entered to win, or you can buy five tickets for $100 and you're entered to win. So the prize packs and all that information will be posted in the CCFR Facebook group, out on Twitter, and also in a mass email. It will open this Friday. So see more information as that becomes available. The prize packs are really, really cool, and especially one of them. I can't remember which one, but they're all, 150th anniversary Remington firearms, like an entire package of all of these engraved limited edition firearms. It's really, really cool. Anyway, on to the next thing. So I did this interview for AM 900 in Vancouver, and I thought it was going to be your typical interview, 7 minutes or so. And it didn't. It wasn't that at all. It was 33 minutes long, and I thought it was really valuable. So I'm going to play that right now. I'm going to come back, give you a couple of parting comments, and this podcast will be over. So check it out. Let us know. Make sure you share the podcast. Make sure you're always engaged in the conversation. We have to stop this madness, or at least slow it down, for God's sake. So anyway, thanks to everybody for their support, and check this out.
The Simi Sara Show, connecting you to the community every day.
I feel like there's a pretty good consensus that we need to protect better our population. And so banning the handguns is one of the way to do it. And so we're asking again the federal government to act on it, to make it more severe, to make it more difficult for the population to have access to that type of guns.
All right, welcome back. This is Mike Smith in for Simi. That was the voice of Montreal Mayor Valerie Plante speaking yesterday as the city of Montreal calls for a national ban on handguns and assault weapons across Canada. This comes after the city of Toronto had issued a similar call after a gunman opened fire in the city's Greektown district, killing two people and 13 others. What will Justin Trudeau do on this? It's interesting that Prime Minister Justin Trudeau is beginning a two-day cabinet retreat this afternoon in Nanaimo here in British Columbia. This issue certainly will be on the agenda, it appears. After the Danforth shooting, Trudeau was asked whether the government supports hearing more about the issue of gun control from Canadians. Let's have a listen to what he said.
So we are always interested in hearing from a broad range of views about what next steps we can take. We're consulting with experts, we're consulting with Canadians, and we're reflecting on the continued responsibility we have to ensure that Canadians remain safe in their homes, in their streets, and in their communities.
Okay, as Justin Trudeau speaking earlier, Montreal's motion calls on the federal government to strengthen the gun control bill known as Bill C-71. It would not prohibit the private ownership of handguns or military-grade firearms, that bill. The motion does not include firearms for police or security officials. It does take aim at handguns and firearms known as, quote-unquote, assault weapons. Let's check in now with Rod Giltaka. He is the CEO and executive director of the Canadian Coalition for Firearm Rights. I'm very pleased to welcome him. Hi, Rod.
Hey, Mike.
Thanks a lot for spending some time with us today. What are your thoughts on the demands from the city of Montreal for a handgun and assault weapon ban in Canada?
Well, there's so much dishonesty around this topic that I don't think anyone's ever going to be happy. They're not going to achieve anything. And a great example of that is you have a city council in Montreal that voted unanimously, and that's important, to demand that the federal government, you know, outlaw the private possession of handguns and assault weapons when assault weapons have been banned for 80 years in this country. And so they can't get their terminology right. They have no idea what the existing law is, and yet they're demanding that that the government do something. And you know, it has two negative consequences. Number one, it victimizes millions of Canadians that have firearms licenses that don't do anything wrong to deserve this kind of treatment. And it prevents us from tackling the real problem to solve crime. So no one is served by this type of demagoguery.
Okay, let's talk about this assault weapon issue here right now. And maybe I think the important thing is to get our terms straight about exactly what an assault weapon or an assault rifle really is. Because you mentioned you're saying that these weapons are already illegal in the country. I mean, if we're talking about a military-grade machine gun where you pull the trigger and the bullets fire continuously until the gun's empty, is that how you would define an assault weapon? That's illegal in Canada, correct?
That's correct. Well, in fact, just to be accurate, because there's a big problem with accuracy in this conversation that we're having in Canada right now. Assault weapons is sort of a nickname that's been floated around, but just for now, we'll say that's an accurate description. That describes a military firearm that is select fire, meaning that it's capable of full automatic or burst fire, that kind of stuff. And those have been illegal for civilians to own, you know, in recent history. So those don't exist. And then the next step down that they're talking about is semi-automatic rifles or shotguns. And I guess the question is whether those should be outlawed in handguns too. Our position has always been that if you're concerned about people being shot illegally, look at who's shooting. Are they licensed individuals? And where are they getting their firearms? So those are important questions.
Okay. When activists in gun control activists use the term assault rifle, they're referring to a weapon like an AR-15, right? Like, which is a semi-automatic long gun, which is that's legal in Canada, right?
Right. You need the highest level firearms license that we have available to civilians to purchase and possess and operate an AR-15, which is a restricted possession and acquisition license.
Right. And I guess that's what, you know, if we're talking about these quote-unquote assault weapons, that's the type of weapon we're talking about. Let me play this for you, Rod. This is a clip of Montreal City Councillor Marvin Rotrand. I just want to get your thoughts on what he says here. Have a listen.
I have to ask the following question. Who needs an assault rifle anyways? Who needs a military-grade assault rifle, which you can legally acquire under certain circumstances? It's not really a weapon for self-defense. It's not even a weapon for hunting. So why is it permitted to be relatively easily acquirable?
Okay, Rod, what do you say to him?
It's demagoguery, and Marvin clearly doesn't know what he's talking about. He's appealing to emotion. And, you know, I get that kind of politics. Like, I understand that. But assault weapons, as we've established, have been prohibited forever. You can't buy them. And besides, even StatsCan would admit in the data that they've been able to aggregate, which is very little, that fully automatic firearms are almost never used in violent crime or in any crime whatsoever in Canada at all. So if he's talking about semi-automatic rifles or rifles that just maybe look scary, which is the basis of his argument, rifles that look scary, who needs them? There are a variety of reasons why people own firearms in Canada, and they're justifiable reasons, completely justifiable.
Oh, okay, if we talk about the AR-15 assault rifle, right, which is probably the most famous example, mm-hmm. essentially, I mean, you're the expert. You correct me if my misunderstanding of this weapon is correct. But if it's a semi-automatic weapon like this one, like an AR-15, it means that a cartridge is automatically reloaded into the gun's chamber after every pull of the trigger, right? So it doesn't mean like correct. you don't have to cock it with a bolt or a lever or a pump action rifle or gun. The next bullet is automatically loaded into the chamber after that. Right. So that is what why should that be allowed? I mean, who would need a gun like that? Could you bring in a rule? What would you say if the government was saying, "Okay, we're not going to allow a semi-automatic rifle now." Now you would have to have a rifle that requires a bolt or a lever or a pump or some sort of break action rifle that would require you to manually load the next bullet.
Well, there's a variety of reasons why Canadians own firearms. I see what you're saying.
But that's the whole debate around assault weapons, isn't it?
Right. Well, they're not assault weapons, but let's say semi-autos.
Okay.
And the thing is, there are a ton of regulations around the possession of semi-autos. In Canada, it's illegal for you to possess a firearm unless you go through the process, which is extensive. And I think what's really important for people to realize is that you are monitored every single day. Your name is run through CPIC every single day. If you have a license to possess these types of firearms, it's very stringent. It's very strict. And I think for anyone to make a justifiable case why people shouldn't have normal firearms, you know, a semi-automatic is just a modern firearm, then they have to show that licensed gun owners actually represent a disproportional threat to public safety, and that should justify taking guns away from 2.1 million licensed gun owners that haven't done anything to deserve that kind of treatment. And it's a question of fundamental justice and fairness.
What about a handgun ban? That's the other side of this this call from the city of Montreal and the city of Toronto as well for a national ban on handguns in Canada. Your thoughts on that?
Well, I guess we'd have to figure out what problem we're trying to solve with a handgun ban. So for sake of discussion, let me know what problem we're trying to solve by banning handguns.
Well, I guess they would argue it's a public safety issue. It's to prevent shootings from handguns, suicides, accidents. And why would anyone need a handgun?
Okay. So, this is the question. This is the assertion they keep making. Well, there's all these shootings in our urban centers, and this is the reason why we need to ban handguns. Well, handguns are essentially banned in Canada and have always been banned. And the only way that you can legally possess them is if you have a restricted PAL, which, again, you know, we talked briefly about what those restrictions and those obligations are.
Right.
So who is doing all the shootings? Well, the escalation in shootings in urban centers in Canada is a result of gang activity. In fact, even the Danforth shooter obtained his firearm, his handgun, illegally through a gang. And we don't even know where that handgun came from. And there's another topic there where they come from, and we can get into that later if you want. But if you're looking at who's doing the shooting, then you need to clamp down on them to prevent shooting. So the suggestion is we want to ban handguns that are already illegal for anyone to possess other than licensed gun owners. And we're trying to stop the gangs who are in unlawful possession of these using that technique. So, I mean, it's ridiculous. It's doing something completely unrelated to stop a problem, you know, that's unrelated to your action. It doesn't help public safety, and it hurts people like me that haven't done anything to have my handgun taken away or saddled with additional regulation or whatever, right?
Okay. I'll jump in there, Rod. We'll take a quick break. We'll come back and continue with my guest, Rob Giltaka. He is the president of the Canadian Coalition for Gun Rights. Phone me up on this now and tell me what you think. If you have a comment or question, the city of Montreal joining the city of Toronto calling for a ban on handguns in Canada, 604-280-9898 is the number to call. 604-280-9898, star 9898 on your cell. Back after this. All right, welcome back. Mike Smith in for Simi today. Rod Giltaka is my guest, CEO and executive director, the Canadian Coalition for Firearm Rights, and talking about the call for by the city of Montreal for a national ban on handguns and assault-style weapons. 604-280-9898 is the number to call. 604-280-9898, star 9898 in your cell. Let's go to Anthony. Hi.
Hi. I worked in a regional trauma hospital in Metro Vancouver here for 13 years. Every single gunshot injury that I ever saw was a large caliber handgun, semi-automatic, 9mm, 45, or a 357 Magnum. Okay, I can't count the number of victims that had gunshot wounds that were entry points and exit points. These are very powerful handguns. I go shooting with a friend. We go plinking with a 22 caliber automatic handgun. We go for fun. Now, these people that are coming in with these guns here, and basically it's the gang-length shootings, these are illegal weapons to start with, and they're bringing them in across the states. When I trained in the U.S., just about everybody in my class had a handgun. We didn't. Three Canadians out of 20 did not have, 17 Americans, three Canadians. The three Canadians didn't have guns. The Americans just got guns like they get up in the morning with a handgun and their cell phone. They just carry them. Yeah. So I'm not for the ban. To solve the problem, you have to go after the illegal guns. That's really the problem here. Illegal guns, people. Large caliber, illegal guns. Thank you.
Anthony, thank you for a good call. Rod, the caller kind of picks up on a point you made earlier about illegal guns. Where do these illegal guns come from?
Well, that's an interesting topic because recently the justification that Ralph Goodale was making, as well as others, Toronto City Council, Mayor Tory, we're all quoting this, over 50% of the illegal guns seized by gangs or crime guns were domestically sourced. They were pushing this for a while until it was clearly debunked by access to information requests from Dennis Young that it turned out that they had no idea where any of these guns were coming from. Even the tracing authority for the RCMP said they don't know where the guns are coming from. So the only thing I would say about all of this whole topic in general is we have to have an honest discussion if we're going to solve these problems. If we can't have honesty in this discussion and have that discussion, then we're never going to solve these problems, and we're just going to continue to divide Canadians.
Let's go to Mike on the open line. Hi, Mike. What do you think?
Good morning, gentlemen. You know, as a police officer, public safety is at the forefront of my mind. I carry a gun every day, and I'm out there dealing with the Canadian public, good, bad, and ugly. So the devil's in the details, and if we don't get our public safety policy right, no one's better off. And so thank you, Mike, for, you know, dealing with terminology. Terminology is important. Firearms legislation is a far better word than gun control because inanimate objects don't really need to be controlled. But I don't support a ban. Semi-automatic firearms in this country are all limited to a 5-round magazine. So no matter whether it's an AR-15, which may look dead sexy and mean and or ugly, depending on your point of view, it's no different than a wood-stocked conventional hunting rifle that's semi-automatic. They're limited by law to a 5-round magazine only.
Rod,
so essentially, they're all the same.
Thank you for a good call, Mike. Rod, is that correct?
That's absolutely correct. And now you've heard from a police officer and a trauma surgeon. Yeah. And I just had a trauma surgeon on my podcast, the last one that I put out. And, you know, when they say the experts all agree that we need a ban on assault weapons, that may or may not exist, or even semi-autos or handguns, that's not true as well.
Is it possible in Canada to modify one of these guns to put a larger clip in there, or a larger magazine of bullets, or is it strictly 5?
Well, absolutely it is. And this is the thing. Who uses a 5-round magazine in a semi-automatic rifle? It's people like me, right? People that have a license, people that obey the law. So You know, can you smuggle, if you can smuggle an illegal gun in from the United States, you can smuggle in an illegal magazine. So the laws that we have on the books apply to the law abiding. And that's why tweaking the laws that only apply to licensed gun owners is going to do nothing to deter the behavior of criminals. We have to go after gangs. I mean, a popular misconception is if you disagree with gun control, you somehow want a more dangerous Canada. But gun owners want a safer Canada because gun owners are actually highly vetted, productive members of our society. So I agree with the previous caller.
Rod, we got a ton of calls here to get through as well. Can you stick around for a few more minutes?
I'd love it.
Okay, let's do that through the news here. We got your news coming up, and then more of your calls in gun control. 604-280-9898 is the number to call. *9898 on your cell. Rod Giltaka, Canadian Coalition for Firearm Rights, is my guest. This is Mike Smith. Stick around. All right, welcome back. Mike Smith in for Simi as we continue talking about the gun control debate in our country. The city of Montreal joining the city of Toronto now and calling for a national handgun and assault weapon ban. That's the subject of our hot question of the day on Twitter, by the way. Would you support a ban like that? Let's check in on the results on that right now. 78% of you say yes to the ban, according to our poll on Twitter today. Just 22% say no. Here's how you can vote on that today. Go on Twitter, at CKNW on Twitter. Follow me there while you're there, please. Mike Smith News on Twitter. Smith spelled with a Y, S-M-Y-T-H. Mike Smith News on Twitter, and vote in that hot question of the day. You can also phone me at any time in the Buzz line. Leave me a voicemail there. 604-331-BUZZ is the number to call. 604-331-2899. Continuing my discussion now with my guest, Rod Giltaka. He is the president and CEO of the Canadian Coalition for Firearm Rights. And your calls to him, 604-280-9898 is the number, *9898 on your cell. Let's go to Joe on the open line. Hi.
Good morning.
Hi, go ahead.
I believe the vast majority of news about firearms carnage is being created by gang violence. And I think that the gang should be targeted, or anybody who's using firearms in an illegal fashion, but particularly gangs. Make it so prohibitively expensive for them with mandatory, say, 5-year incarceration for being caught with a firearm, particularly if they already have a firearm prohibition.
Rod, do you have any thoughts on that?
Well, absolutely. I mean, I'd like to see all of these politicians call a national ban on gangs or a national strategy on gangs and really victimize the people that are creating the victims. I just think that makes sense, no?
Let's go to Clint on the open line. Hi, Clint.
Hi there.
Hi, go ahead.
Thanks for having me. I just want to mention something. So Mike had asked you two different questions. One was, he asked, why do we need access to handguns? And the second was, why do we need access to semi-automatic rifles? So you had answered both of them as, we have many reasons why. Like, there's many reasons. So I'm just asking, can you give me three?
Okay, go ahead, Rod.
Okay, I can give you five. So when it comes to non-restricted firearms, which are typically rifles and shotguns, including semi-automatics, there's five legal reasons. That's hunting, target shooting, collecting, inheritance, and protection of life is actually a legal reason to possess a firearm. It's actually in the Firearms Regulation as well as in the Firearms Act in three separate sections. So those are all legal reasons to possess a firearm.
Okay, what about a handgun? Would you apply all those to a handgun as well?
All of them do legally apply except for hunting.
Let's go to Paul in the open line. Hi, Paul.
Hey, Mike. How are you?
Good. What do you think?
Well, I think, you know, one thing that that Rod said, and the point has been made time and time again, is that, you know, you can throw more laws at something, but those laws are only going to affect law-abiding citizens. And I think it's a bit naive, because I think it's genuine, because I think the people who are making the laws are coming from a place where, well, if it was illegal, I wouldn't do it. And so, therefore, if we make it illegal, nobody will do it, because, of course, everybody thinks like I do. And I think that's the naive flaw in all of this. Canada's gun control legislation is extremely strict, as Rod pointed out. There is no legal way to purchase a firearm of any kind in this country unless you are legally licensed and vetted. And as Rod pointed out, CPIC check every single day, right? Round the clock, all year long, every single day. Every licensed firearm owner in this country is run through CPIC. I don't know how more stringent we can be. And I think the naivety is that they're ignoring the fact that people who choose to break the law are going to break the law, and they're not going after them with these new laws, right? They're ignoring that because it's difficult to work on these problems. They're hard to solve in four-year term. And so it's an easy target to add more laws. And I don't see a point to it. And I see it as being a waste. And I see it as being really letting down Canada where public safety is concerned.
Okay, Paul, thank you for the call. I appreciate that. Let's talk a little bit, Rod, about some of the points that he made there. Like, what do you got to do to get a handgun in Canada? Like, what kind of checks, background checks do you have to go through? What are the restrictions on where a handgun could be used or stored, that kind of thing?
There's a lot, but I'm going to try to make it as quick as possible. You have to take a two-day safety course. It's probably going to cost you at the end of the process somewhere around $500. And it takes about anywhere from 6 months to a year, depending on the backlog. You got to take the safety course. You have to disclose all of your conjugal partners for 2 years. You have to actually have a sign-off and signature from your spouse that they're not concerned. You have to disclose any medications you've been on, criminal history, mental illness. You have to disclose a ton of stuff. Then the government will decide whether you get a firearms license. Once you have that restricted firearms license to buy a handgun, then you have to go through the process of buying one. All handguns have been registered in this country since, I believe it's 1974. If memory serves me, I have a lot of facts and figures floating around up there. And then you can only take a handgun to certain places right now, shooting range, border crossing to go to a competition, gun show, gunsmith, and a peace officer to turn the firearm in for destruction or verification. And so it's very restrictive. And the people that have PALs follow every law, no matter how ridiculous, without question. And that's why it's such an affront to gun owners to be further blamed for criminal shootings by people that are not licensed.
604-280-9898 is the number to call. 604-280-9898, *9898 on your cell. Let's go to Dustin. Hi.
Hi there. How's it going?
Good. What do you think?
I'm totally against the handgun ban, and I think I'm very glad to hear from that surgeon and police officer from their opinion. But I want to take a bit of a different aspect rather than just the gangs and who's responsible for shooting. I think a lot of legitimate purposes include competition, for example. I was actually just in Prince George a few weeks ago shooting a competition called Three Gun, which involves a semi-auto rifle. So in my case, I used an AR-15, a semi-auto shotgun, and a semi-auto handgun. And we had competitors all the way from Ontario, Saskatchewan, all coming to northern BC and, you know, pushing up the tourism there. And it was a fantastic place. You know, one of the things there, because I took my dad, who's not a gun owner, with me, was that he was so shocked how everyone just kept their guns. You know, we were not worried about anyone stealing anything or, you know, anything going missing, because when you're at a gun range with 100 other gun owners in a competition, that is the last place you should be worried about any, you know, ne'er-do-wells or anything like that. So I think when we look at the organized competition shooting in Canada, there's quite a good look into how well vetted and how just honestly good these people are in the gun community.
Dustin, thank you for the call. Let's go to Annette on the open line. Hi.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm good. What do you think?
Good. I am not for the ban. I am, whenever I check on the my status on my application for my RPEL, it always says, thank you for being a legal firearms owner. I'm not an owner yet. I've been waiting 9 months to get my license.
What kind of gun were you trying to get?
Well, I want to go hunting. I want to provide for my family. I want to go to the range. I can't even join a range without my PAL.
Yeah, thank Annette. Annette, thank you very much for that. How long is the waiting time, Rod, to get a gun?
It's to get a PAL, typically 3 to 6 months, depending on the backlog. And there you go. Someone's waiting 9 months. And unfortunately, again, part of the misinformation and the dishonesty is people walking around like your Marvin, the city councilor in Montreal, saying, oh, it's like nothing to get a gun in Canada. And it's just not true.
604-280-9898 is the number to call. *9898 on your cell. Let's do one more call here before the break. Hi, Kevin.
Hey, thanks for having me on.
Sure.
I just wanted to make two quick points. Pretty much everybody's made, they've taken the wind out of my sails for everything else I was going to say. Two things. One, if it's automobiles, we've got a bunch of drivers on the road, let's change the subject, and there's a few bad drivers, you penalize the better drivers over and over again. You're not actually dealing with the problem. The problem is people speeding, et cetera. So I wanted to make that point, which, you know, coincides with everyone else saying that. And the other thing I wanted to point out was there was a fellow, I'm in Vancouver, I was walking down Granville Street, gang member, had a firearm on him, he was arrested. They gave him, I think it was a year conditional sentence. That fellow was involved in a shooting in Vancouver the year earlier. So we do need to be penalizing the people with firearms. He wasn't a licensed owner. He had a firearm on Granville Street. He's a gang member, and he got a year conditional sentence. That's unacceptable. He doesn't need that.
Okay, Kevin, thanks for the call. Let's take a break. We'll come back and keep the conversation going. Keep phoning me up on this and telling me what you think. 604-280-9898 is the number to call. 604-280-9898. Star 9898 on your cell. Rod Kiltaka is my guest, Canadian Coalition for Gun Rights. More of your calls after this. All right, welcome back to the show. This is Mike Smith filling in for Simi today as we continue talking about the gun control debate in our country. My guest, Rob Kiltaka, Canadian Coalition for Gun Rights. Your call is to him, 604-280-9898. Hi, Andrew.
Hello.
Hi there, go ahead.
It's hard to know where to start on this. I think most of your guests and a lot of the callers have already covered a lot of the logical stuff, but to be honest, I think a big part of the problem is actually media. I'll notice that when you're talking to your guest, you, even after he corrected you on the erroneous term assault rifle, you continued to use the term. And that's a big problem with the media.
No, hang on a second here. You know, you're full of it because I went over
it
very
clearly.
Listen to me now. I went over this very clearly with the guest of exactly what the definitions are of an assault rifle. Did you hear that part?
I hear them. You continue to use the term.
That's what the city of Montreal is calling for. They're calling for a ban on an assault style weapon. We went over very clear. We went over very clear. Open your ears. Take the cotton out of your ears and listen to what I'm saying. Listen to the whole show. Don't cherry pick and start going on fake media. I went over this very clearly with the guest what the definition is. Of a semi-automatic weapon.
The term.
What's your point, man?
Use the term. The problem is that if media is going to cover something, at the very least, they should do some research on it to ensure that they're.
Did you listen to what I just said to you?
Yeah.
We went over this Rod, did I not go over this with you in detail?
Well, yes, we did.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Let's go to Matthew on the open line. Hello.
Hey guys, how are you today?
Go ahead.
I have a quick statement and then a question for Rod. So I'm a cutlery lover. I love knives. I collect them. And it's not just the gun laws, but the weapon laws in this country, too. They don't make sense, and they're backwards. An automatic knife is no more dangerous than a kitchen knife. And kitchen knives are usually the weapons that are used for attacks. Now, the question for Rod is that we're talking about banning handguns. We're talking about being stricter on criminals. So why don't we talk about Bill C-71 and Bill C-75 and how they kind of contradict each other?
Okay, let's talk about the bill in front of the House of Commons, Rod. Tell me your perspective on it.
C-71 is the firearms bill. And the entire bill, aside from the money to battle guns and gangs, is aimed squarely at people that possess PALs. And that's a real problem. That's a waste of resources and money, of course. And then the other money in the bill was funding that was promised in the election campaign of the Liberal government and still hasn't been paid out. So all of this, and that's why it's an issue, right? So all of the only measure that would stop the gun or, you know, deter gangs isn't being implemented. And everything else that is foisted on licensed gun owners they want to implement that stuff. So that's why there's a real issue.
604-280-9898 is the number to call. Star 9898 on your cell. Hi, James.
Hi there. I just wanted to share something with you. I'm from High River, And when we had the flood in High River, the RCMP completely shut down the town. They took the information from the long gun registry that they had in place at the time. They broke into people's houses, and they said that they were securing their weapons. And in my house, they broke down a $3,000 oak door that was fully secured. They tried to remove my gun safe, which is concreted into the floor, and they said it was to protect our own safety. Now, I think that if they're going to make the laws, they have to make the laws a lot more stricter on the people that abuse them. And I think that they have to be a lot more trusting in people that go through the hoops to get the weapons in the first place.
Were they worried about looting or someone breaking into your home during a disaster or something? Is that...
Well, no, we had a monster flood in the river down there. Yeah. And it basically shut down the whole town. They called in, they had over 300 RCMP officers surrounding the town. And they used the information that they had from the registry to enter people's homes to secure their guns. And I had a number of my neighbors where they did manage to secure the guns, and it took them months and months and months to recover their guns.
Rod, have you ever heard? Thank you for the call. Rod, have you ever heard anything like that?
Well, that's one of the biggest stories in Canadian history that gets overlooked constantly. And one of the reasons, I think, why you'll find gun owners saying not one more inch is because if you have a lot of legislation and regulation and an infrastructure to control guns themselves, you have to be able to trust the people that are administrating that. And High River was a big deal, and it never got reported like it should. It was a real problem.
Let's go to Mike on the open line. Hi.
Hi, Mike.
Hi,
yeah,
go ahead.
I'd forgotten about the High River thing until he brought it up, and that's right. That was quite a debacle. So one of the callers earlier was asking, you know, about the reasons, and you mentioned collecting, and then you mentioned inheritance, and I'm a great example of that. I have my great-grandfather was a wonderful shot, was a champion shooter in Vancouver back in the late 1800s, so I have two of his long rifles. One's a black powder one, one is a, I forget what caliber it is now. I've never shot them. I don't think you could shoot them safely, but I still have to have a PAL in order to possess those. And for myself, I enjoy shotguns and trap shooting, so that's the reason that I own firearms. And I'm finding that a lot of the callers are very much in agreement with your guest.
I think
myself.
And, Mike, thank you for the call. I think just about every caller has been on Rod's side of this thing, on this debate, and opposed to the call from the city of Montreal and also the city of Toronto on this. Our online poll is showing a different result on the other side, but the open line calls are certainly a different story. Rick, you got to go fast because we're almost out of time.
Mike, L'École Politique last year when they had their 20th anniversary, not anniversary, celebration of the disaster there. Yes. After weeks of announcements and everything else, the day came around and a few pollsters did polls. And
make your point. Bottom line it for me.
Against any kind of guns. I've been shooting all my life, and the poll was so skewed because of the bad politics.
Thanks for calling in. Rod, thank you for your time today.
Anytime. I appreciate it.
Rod Giltaka, Canadian Coalition for Gun Rights.
All right. So hopefully you found that interview interesting and valuable, you know, just for some of the points. So and thanks, everybody, for supporting the podcast and listening to it. Everyone I talk to that says, oh, you know, thanks for your work or whatever, I always go, do you listen to the podcast? And they say, yeah. So I think we actually have a lot of people listening to this, and I can't be more thankful for all of you guys donating, becoming members, doing the Patreon thing. Even just being out there and being part of the conversation, we can't give up, because if we give up, the antis will steamroll us. I've never seen a push as long as I've been a gun owner like I see right now. It's actually terrifying to me, to be honest, right? So keep up all the good work, support us on Patreon, become one of the CCFR insiders. The first insider broadcast or Facebook Live or whatever conversation will happen this Thursday with me and Wilson, broadcasting live from Halifax at the CPC convention. So you'll be able to talk to us while we're there. So Patreon, search for CCFR, $20 or more. Make sure you do it by Wednesday, actually, for us to get you included in this Thursday's Facebook Live. And obviously, stay tuned for the the contest that's going to be released on Friday. So thanks for your support. Keep up the fight, and we'll see you all soon.
This is another episode of the CCFR Radio Podcast. Remember, if you don't stand up for your own ability to own and use firearms, who will? Join the CCFR or donate right now at www.firearmrights.ca.